Here we go. Only the inner guru really knows. The external gurus are very helpful, but the inner guru, which is really the Holy Spirit, actually, only the Holy Spirit really knows what we, how to orchestrate our lives, moment by moment by moment by moment by moment. So we could do all this non-dual study and words and all this as much as we want, but the inner guru has the real blueprint for our awakening, and so, for me it keeps orchestrating stuff, and I just like say, wow. Why this? I don't know, right? It's that you're mentally you're fine, but physically, there's something about our. It's bigger than enlightenment, you might say. It's bigger than that, actually. You have to put that into context. In how do you help others? How do you? What's the big picture? Because most are still in extreme ignorance, meaning they're ignoring truth. They're ignoring it. So when you're enlightened, you just say, okay, well, that's part of it. That's. But I have to feel and get used to the context of. Well, how do I help others? I mean, what am I going to do with this? It's a big picture. So enlightenment is you might say, it's a step in the right direction. But don't overplay it. Say, okay, I'll accept this step now, and get used to this, and gradually you work into seeing bigger picture. How do you down the road? Obviously most are not getting it at this time, and it's amazing how steeped in ignorance they are. It's so extraordinary that when you're not steeped in ignorance, you just can't. It's difficult to even fathom, moment by moment by moment they choose ignorance, moment by moment by moment by moment by moment, their whole lives. And it's just, I can't relate to that, because I'm just the opposite. So somehow there has to be a way, a bigger picture to see, how can these people be helped? I mean, they're investing in despair is all they're doing. That's it. So welcome to the video. It's not easy to be super positive right now in the world, is it? No, it isn't. The distraction is reaching a crescendo. Well, it's building towards a crescendo. The crescendo is yet to come. It's like you're listening to the symphony and it's building up, up to that the crescendo is coming in the fourth movement or third or fourth movement, and you could feel it building up. And you realize, wow, this is going to be a whopper when the crescendo comes. And it's designed to just, stir you into some sort of altered state, you might say. The crescendo, right? In a symphony. Why do they have those crescendos anyway? I should know. But this to drive you, it's trying to make you feel something different than the norm, or to amplify something, or it's stir something up in you and get you into a certain cultural pathway. So here comes the crescendo in this world. What does the Holy Spirit have me doing? This is the question. Well, I'm producing slideshows that really better than ever, but less views than ever. It's pretty interesting. It's pretty shocking, actually. I don't know how I can do any better. Hey, Holy Spirit finds a way to, and we'll see. But it also has to be working out physically, because it says physically you have work to do. What does that mean? Physically you have work to do. It means that we're so used to believing the body is responsible for our lives that it's extremely difficult to just ignore the body. And I tried doing that, and the Holy Spirit said, yeah, but it probably will go better for you now during this phase if you, get the body in shape. And What I do is spiritual cross training. I've been sort of, Holy Spirit has helped invent these various exercises for me and various things I do. So today I did the first full hour workout. I did an hour workout of all sorts of unusual exercising, falling, tumbling, spilling, just you name it. I just did this very rolling. I did rolling. Everything I said I would do, I'm doing. I actually rolled back and forth supine on the ground and just practiced rolling along the ground. Then I'd stop and go the other direction, go back and forth. I literally did that today. I did things where I would sit on this ball and suddenly I'd spill and tumble like this and I'd fall down this all different directions. And I had my wrist guards on that I have got for skateboarding, but they're really great to break your fall when you do this, because you put your wrist down to break your fall, right? So I have these wonderful wrist guards. I could tell you what brand they are. I don't know. They work great. They're really, really good. They weren't expensive at all. I recommend these. So there's this whole fitness program the Holy Spirit's had me do, and it has to do with 360-degree non-linear sort of stuff that I'm doing. It's very much balance oriented and non-linear, but you're moving this direction 360 degree. You never know which way you're going, and it somehow is helping out spiritually. So the Holy Spirit is a spiritual cross trainer 360 degrees. It sees the whole picture, not just the thoughts and concepts and non-dual meditation and all this stuff. Everything. It sees everything. So it wants me to work out more. I'm like, oh, wow. It's pretty amazing, isn't it? I keep thinking, no, I've got to keep focusing on, how much... How long does it take to get rid of nothing? Okay, and Holy Spirit's saying, no, you need to like fall off these rubber balls. You need to like practice falling backwards and sideways and spilling and stuff. And I'm saying, okay, I intuitively get it, because our body is so roboticized now that we're afraid that we defend anything that might. It gets into us mentally. We think, well, the body is telling me to be linear, because the body's all programmed to be linear. It seems that way, but it's really our mind that's programmed that way. But we think it's the body, and so we think the body's to blame for our troubles. And so what I'm finding out is the body could spill, the body could roll, we could do these things, and the mind says, what? 360 degreeness. Kids have that, don't they? They're spilling, they're tumbling, they're rolling, they're going this way, they're going that way. Because their mind is like that. The mind can go in any direction. I was running up a hill backwards today, and someone said, you know what, that's great, great practice like that. It's a great workout to do that. He noticed it. I said, yeah, it is. Running up a hill backwards. Now, who does that? Like the exercises I do, who does this? Virtually nobody. But it's an expression of the 360 degreeness of now, of our true nature. And so in this time in the world where we are so obsessed with physicality, the Holy Spirit says you can't really just ignore it. It doesn't work very well. It's not working very well to just ignore it. It's everywhere. It's so much part of our modern world. So when I walk, I'm walking sideways. I'm doing dance steps, or like putting one leg behind the other and twisting this way, walking backwards, skipping, doing, trying to just do different stuff that you get used to it, and you feel, I can move this way, I can move this way, I can move this way. Well, also mentally, we can move this way, we can move this way, we can move this way. We're so, if the body can't do it, we feel like we can't do it. This is how strong our identification is, culturally. We say, well, I can't do that. What do you mean? Well, my body can't do that. Well, what do you mean? Your mind can't do that? Yeah. So if the body can roll, the mind can roll over too. Mental turnover time. So the Holy Spirit is still pushing me. I'm like, good Lord. So today, again, I busted out the full repertoire, really. I'm inventing so much stuff for training. That's a type of spiritual exercises that will benefit us. Pretty astonishing, huh? It really is. I checked out price of surfboards, too expensive. I was really shocked. I said, yeah, I could probably get something, a surfboard for like $30, $40. I said, no. Everything's expensive now. It's like, wow. Okay, well, but I'm like simulating. I'm able to simulate like riding a surfboard and simulate paddling and stuff. And it seems like we need to work on the physical also, not just the mental. We're not getting it. You know, the people, we're trying, we're up against something that is really troublesome. So this workout was pretty amazing in its versatility. I figured out some way to use like the big balance ball, big rubber balance ball for the abs. I'm figuring out stuff as I go along. And it's great. I mean, just rolling on it and then flipping and suddenly falling and tumbling. That's great exercise, actually. It's really is. And I'm literally doing that. I'm tumbling and falling and rolling and getting and bouncing up from it, you know, like a kid. Which is just, it was unfathomable a year ago. It was unfathomable. So I know that spiritually we say, well, it's all in the mind. Yes. But we're so much into the body that it can help. If we liberate the body in certain ways, that can help our mind. It seems to be that there's something along these lines. The Holy Spirit wants us to be able to move in every direction and still feel balanced, and not balanced, beyond balanced. That I can't lose my balance. You see, like even when I'm falling and rolling, I don't feel like I lost my balance. I don't feel that way. Isn't that amazing? There's no panic in my mind. This is what the Holy Spirit's getting to. I'm intentionally, you know, falling. Whoops, I tipped over. Like imagine your chair, just like, you know, tip over in the kitchen or something. Whoa. But I'm doing it like I have these soft mats that so it doesn't hurt me. Okay. I'm not being stupid. I'm not falling on concrete at this point. And I'm noticing that more and more now it's like, oh, okay, this is normal. This too is normal. This is a normal movement. This is a normal movement. There's no panic. And it's not like, oh, I need to regain my balance. It's like I never lose my balance. Whether I'm bouncing on the ball or I'm suddenly whoops, going off, you know, flipping. I still feel like this too is just a movement in spaciousness. And I'm not thrown out of whack by it. You know, this is what the Holy Spirit is getting to. This is very profound what we're engaged in here. It really is. This is unique. It's not something you come across very often. This is something the Holy Spirit is helping us with going forward in our you know, experiencing going forward, that we can have a spiritual cross training. It's not just this or this or this. It's from every angle that we feel we never lose our balance. Everything we do is right there in the flow. The different Dharma kings. I look at this one, I do a video on this one, this one, this one, this one. How many have done? I've done Nisargadatta Maharaj, Ramaharshi, Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, Jesus Christ, and I've done Longchenpa. recently. And it's all, I don't feel like I've lost my balance in any of them at all. I feel, you know, like I'm always not even in balance, but always just feel just right. There's no such thing as balance. Balance implies you could lose your balance. But if every movement you make is you're, you know, you still feel everything's perfectly fine, then how can we even worry about balance or not balance? See, it sort of helps us with this non-dualness, is this falling. It's pretty amazing. And, you know, the concept came to me. The Holy Spirit introduced this to me. And then it got the necessary stuff that I needed to actually practice this way, which is quite extraordinary. Just it showed up like boom, 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 like that. It's amazing. I said I'd asked the Holy Spirit for help, and it like that. Everything I needed just showed up within a day or two. And so today I deployed it, and I started and then broke through the threshold of actually doing it. You know, it's one thing to get an idea. It's another thing to actually do it. And you wonder, what's going to happen? Oh, I'm going to fall. Am I going to hurt myself? You know, and actually it was quite fun. I rolled and spun and, you know, landed, and I didn't hurt myself. I took some tumbles for sure. It's like, whoa. But I avoided any troubles. And this builds a some kind of like different, unique type of confidence that very few in the world have, don't they? You think about it. How many people spend time just rolling along the ground? I can't remember the last time I saw anybody do that. Or intentionally throwing themselves into awkward such positions that they stumble or fall. And yet it's all just part of the dance. You know, it's just like the dance. It's a dance that continues. And there's this part of the dance and this part of the dance. But you're still, you're still dancing. Even when I'm falling, I feel I'm still dancing. So that's a pretty interesting mindset, isn't it? Like if you fall, most people will be mortified and, oh my gosh, how did this happen? I'm shocked, you know. But in doing this intentionally, there isn't none of that reaction occurred, actually. So I am intrigued by this. The wrist guards were just a great move. I really recommend them to you. I will see if I can look them up in the model. I mean, these are just great. They're really, really good. It's like essential. One of the things that we should have is these wrist guards. Seriously, you just practice like, whoa, you know, like I'm walking along, suddenly, oops. I kind of stumble. I need to put my hand down to catch my balance. You need to do it on purpose. Do it on purpose. I mean, this is just so amazing what's happening right now. I mean, you know, the wow of it. It's so wowish, actually. It's so wowish. Who would ever have, you know, thought this? Not me. No. Only the Holy Spirit could, you know, have this clearly in mind, and just, it's like, yeah, it knows what it's doing. Wow. And I also practiced on like going supine on the ground with, and then suddenly jumping up to a standing position, like on a surfboard. Like, let's say you're paddling and you catch a wave. You got to jump up, push yourself up, and jump up on a surfboard, right? So I'm practicing that movement, and I was able to do it quite a few times. And we'll see if I can keep practicing it. What is that, though? That's a corollary between the horizontal. You're lying horizontal and you're paddling. This is like everybody in the world is like a slug, horizontal slug. Imagine that this would suddenly pop up and go vertical. You're standing up, you're suddenly vertical. How do you go from horizontal to vertical like that? You know, really spring up. this is the question. And I said, could I do it? I said, I don't know. Yeah, I was able to do it. And I got better at it. So there's a physical corollary to spiritually shifting to the vertical perspective, because this is what settles everything. The vertical perspective means you realize you're the dreamer of all this horizontal. Everything you've been dreaming is totally horizontal. It's totally flat. As soon as you see you're the dreamer, it's all flat. Poof. You're liberated like that. But you have to make this shift to go vertical. So to be lying on the ground on your stomach, face down, and then suddenly just like pop up on your feet, you got to push with your hands, and you know, somehow, you know, spring up. It's, you know, it's doable, but it's a great thing to practice. It's a really, really great to practice. So I guess I was just sort of like a bellwether situation in terms of allowing myself to get out of shape, so that I could show everyone that it's possible to get back in shape. I was like the poster child for being out of shape, and now I'm the poster child for getting back in shape. So I know it's doable. This is the way my life's been. I keep doing, getting into trouble, and then just to get out of it, and just to prove, hey, all these excuses we're making, they're not valid excuses. We don't have any valid excuses. We absolutely can turn back the clock in terms of mentally, and to some degree physically, actually, ultimately, we could take the position that nothing needs to be cured. There's nothing in my body that needs to be cured at all. Take the position, I don't need any cure whatsoever. Instead of trying to cure cancer, say, this cancer doesn't need to be cured at all. I don't have any need for anything to be cured. And this is just tempting me to believe in that I need to be cured of something. But just assert that I don't need to be cured of anything. And guess what? Cancer's gone. Sickness is gone. All this stuff gone. Jesus gets to get death to disappear in an instant. But we can do the same. We can do the same. I don't need to cure anything. Right? What is sick in reality? Nothing. Is my mind sick? No, it isn't. So there's nothing I need to cure. There's absolutely, my body never presents anything that needs to be cured. And insist on this. If there's some affliction you have, say, no, there's nothing I need to have cured. This is merely an illusion trying to tempt me. And I would say that would be much more effective than all the medicines and all every other approach the ego gives us. It is, instead of saying, I have this cancer, I've got to go cure it, I've got to take this medicine, I'm going to cure it, I'm going to beat this cancer, I'm going to cure it. You can say, there's nothing I need to cure. Absolutely nothing I need to cure, and just remain in this confidence. Because what is the cancer? It's just thoughts, just thought forms. Refuse to entertain. Thought forms are always tempting you to cure something, to do something. Say, I don't need to do anything. I don't need to cure anything. And rest in that. This is non-dual. This is a non-dual prescription. I'm writing here a non-dual prescription for us all. Now, it's important when you do workouts of various things not to have anything too preconceived in your mind. I don't really, it's pretty spontaneous. It's just like, when I get up tomorrow, I don't know what I'm going to do exactly. Not exactly. Holy Spirit indicated something as potentially, but some outlines. But I kind of just, you know, it gets better when you don't structure it. You actually invent stuff that's even better than what you could have structured. This is how I see it. Same thing with singing. As soon as you structure, then that's what you're singing. But if you don't structure, guess what? You come up with something better. You're more spontaneous, more creative. So, but you know, there's certain parameters, you work with the situation, but don't try to be spontaneous as much as possible, actually. Don't fixate yourself too much. Be careful about that. So, this was a really over an hour straight. I was working out and all different sorts of things. And it went very well. It's like, oh, okay. Yeah, I could do this. It's very different. I mean, even cross training It's different. They do the swimming, they do biking, they do running. You know, they do this and they do that. A lot of different stuff. Okay, but the workout I'm doing is a little more inspired than that, actually. It's more inspired than that. It's very unusual. Martial arts is along those lines, isn't it? Because you never know where you're going to be thrown. You're grappling and wrestling, grappling. You don't know. You'll be tossed, suddenly tossed upside down on the mat, and it helps you just deal with any and everything surprise. And it's just like nothing surprised me. I'm still exactly where I want to be. Exactly where I want to be. So there is a spiritual component to martial arts. That is true. It is true. I'm seeing that now. If you take it that way, if you train with a good teacher who's grounded in spiritual philosophy, it's like you know you're training like I'm never any place where I don't want to be. Everywhere, no matter where I am, I feel, you know, totally there. I'm always, we call it centered, but I'm always exactly where I want to be. Very interesting. You roll out, you fall, you roll out, you spring to your feet, and it's just all part of this, you know, dance, this flow. You don't go, "Oh, I've fallen. What happened?" You know, and your mind goes into this blank, like, "Oh my gosh, something terrible happened to me. I fell. I wonder what if I'm injured. I want this." No, I fall, roll, pop up, laugh, and say, "Oh, that was fun. Let's do it again." Isn't that how kids are like? Right? They fall. They kind of look at their moms. Everything's okay. They laugh, starts laughing. And say, "Oh, that's pretty. That was fun." But if the mom panics, "Oh my God, are you okay?" The kid's kind of like, "Oh, what happened?" What, you know, scares them. But of course, I'm taking precautions. Of course, yeah, I'm like a cat. I'm cautious. I'm cautious. Conservative. I'm conservative and cautious. But this actually works in to your advantage, because then you're able to do stuff. You don't get hurt, and be able to push it through and keep your momentum going. And I'm not reckless. I don't tend to be reckless. Try not to. And just, you know, let the Holy Spirit lead. Holy Spirit says, "Okay, this you can. Okay, it's safe to do this. Okay." Like, I've only skated once on my skateboard, right? Well, because I haven't felt it, you know, like I need to do some more. I'm not gonna push myself. When it happens, it happens. That's all. It will happen at some point. If it's meant to happen, that's fine. If that's the only time I ever ride it, that's fine too. I just trust at the Holy Spirit. Just trust and keep on practicing spiritually, 360 degreeness. Just do little things like that. Like in a grocery store, I will. Like I said, the clerks last time, I said, "No, the only reason we come here is I come here. I like to dance to the music. That's why I'm here." They really laughed. They thought that was great. They were going to turn the station. Station, I said, "Don't turn the station. I'm really digging the movie. I'm digging the music. I'm really, you know, got dancing to this." "Oh, okay. We don't want to ruin your groove. We'll keep it the way it is." And you know, it's like most people don't do that. You know, they're like, the clerks are young people, and they're kind of like, "Wow, that's kind of cool." Some older person here is not like all locked into some robotic, you know, they're like moving to go down the aisle, dancing and singing. And you know, and some people, they smile and they say, "Yeah, you know, we're not dead, are we?" Why do we have to just like, "I'm pushing a cart, I'm pushing a cart, let me get this, you know, there's some music on." They say, like, spin around, do like push the cart, and then just do a little like pirouette and turn around and just keep pushing the cart. I mean, why not? What's the big deal? You could like do it 360 like in like a second, right? Just break off a 360 and then just keep on moving the cart. Then you might, you know, do a little shuffle step, and then do a little background singing, like woo, 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 and then you know, get your crackers off the shelf and stuff like this, and toss them in the basket. Just kind of like get your 360 degreeness. Keep working. Like everything is just a flow. I'm never out of the flow. I'm always exactly where I want to be, doing exactly what I want to do. And it's all God's grace. Nothing can happen to me that I don't choose to have happen. The Holy Spirit's helping me with this choosing, that'll help me see all this. And just as much as possible, go with the flow. And it's just little things that you can notice. You know, you open up a door, and you might just kind of like slide through it sideways, kind of glide through it, and have a little flourish or something. And you see somebody say hello, and you just go, yeah, and like, hey, or like, ah. You know, use your body language, use your hands, use your thing. Society's becoming so robotic, isn't it? These old world people, I'm listening. People are telling me their mothers are living to be, they're 95 and nothing's wrong with them. They're just going as strong as ever. 95. The Sicilians from Sicily. I mean, those are old world people. They talk with their hands. You know, they get mad. They just let it go, and then everything's fine. They're more 360 degreeness than we are today, right? I mean, today we're just all hunched over, you know, typing on a computer and looking on the phone like this. And I mean, smartphone, everybody's locked into their smartphones. Isn't this causing some mental freeze up? Really? It could be, right? We see the flexibility of on the technology. Well, I can go here, but what's it really happening, you know, to your mind? This is a question, right? So I'm on the computer, I can surf the internet, but I'm just sitting there locked into this. And is it kind of causing a sort of roboticism to take place? It's a question. But these tech people, they're so afraid, they're so brittle, they're so fragile. A lot of them, they just, oh, there's a world there. Oh, you know, I thought the world was in here. And the smartphone, the tablet, and but very few are doing this. I just don't notice people expressing any joie de vivre in terms of, hey, I'm not trapped, I'm not bound, I'm not a slave. So everything, what I do is just expressing like, hey, I'm not a slave. And I believe it's really important for us to get this feeling, I'm not a slave. Because we're going into a time of slavery. The New World Order is a time of slavery. The New Age is a time of slavery. And we may be going somewhere else, actually, in some other scenario where we're not a slave at all. Where the world is a very free world, and our freedom is welcome there. And if we have a slave mentality, we'll feel we don't fit in. We don't fit in, like, we'll freeze up. But if we're used to just like, and we could do it to a much greater extent, but I'm very careful just to keep it, you know, under wraps. But if you see a tree or something, you may just feel like do a little dance and sing a little song or something. Or you see a flower and the flower's there, and it's going, moving in the breeze. And you just may like want to move in the breeze and like dance with the flower. Just do a little like that. Or a little song, a little background harmony to its presence. It's a song. Everything's a song, actually. I heard once I heard the music of the spheres, that's what it's called. I've experienced this, directly experienced it. It was so intense, I could not contain it within my psyche. Everything is singing a song, actually. And there's just this one song being sung, and everything is contributing to this one song. And it's all a harmonious tapestry, actually. Every blade of grass, everything. And so you can sing a song, background, sing harmony with everything. Everything is sounding its song, and you can harmonize with everything, actually. And we, if we do that, people think we're kooky or something. But it's really preparing us for a better situation than this roboticism here, which is really appalling, very appalling. You might just stand in this beautiful field, just go, ah, you know, ah, ooh, ooh, and just something that just, you know, I mean, indigenous peoples like the Native American Indians did all these chants, and the Tibetans, they do all this vocalization. What is that about anyway? Maybe they're just harmonizing with stuff that they're hearing, actually. You know that? Or they're just expressing creativity or something. Or a mountain, you see a mountain, and you know, you might just feel like vocalizing. It doesn't have to be words at all. In fact, I'm getting away from words altogether in my singing and harmonizing. You don't use any words at all. You don't really need to. Mountain, ah, you just do a high, you know, just, ah, ooh. I'm doing it real quietly because everybody's asleep around here. But maybe someday, I don't know. Who knows? I don't like to predict what I'm going to do. You never know. I never know what I'm going to do, actually. I don't. I don't have any idea what I'm going to do. Except I know it'll be done with grace and appropriately. But as far as what I now, I mean, it's just, I'm open to the moment. But that's the opposite of roboticism, isn't it? It's closed to every moment. It's closed to everything except its own, its programming. It's not open to the moment. We're not open to the moment when we're becoming robotic. So this is very different than most of the stuff. Like I'm noticing now on the internet. I've looked at so much of the internet, and it's just, there's no inspiration there. It's not real inspiration. I'm not finding it. Not finding a lot of it. You know, these non-dual quotes are great, but is this really inspiration? Does it really rise to the level of inspiration? Not necessarily. Not necessarily. It could just be, as Ramaharshi really pointed this out very strenuously. He says, look, you know, is a severe illness cured by repeating the name of the medicine? No, you got to take the medicine. And so, what is it that's interfering? Continuity fear is interfering. What are we so scared of? 360 degreeness. Well, our body, most people's bodies are so used to, it's really the mind, but we think it's the body. The patterns, we think the body is the one that is constricting us, where it's not really, but it certainly seems that way. So it's very pragmatic, to go at it from both angles. Go at it from both angles. Our mind is so resistant to the notion. No, no, no. It says, no, no, no. The problem is the body's become, you know, all rigid and everything. Well, not really, but it does get out of shape because it's not used to moving in certain ways. So, you move, working with the body to move in different ways. I mean, body work, I used to have a position on it where I said, that's not really the answer. But so I have to, you know, modify that to some extent at this point. What happened was they discovered something, but they didn't quite put it in the right context. And so this is what I was kind of irritated me. I just said, you know, we can do better than this. But a lot of body work and stuff has been done. This was back in the 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s. You go through all sorts of stuff, right? I can't remember all the stuff. Alexander Technique, Feldenkrais, Primal Scream, just all sorts of gestalt, Rolfing, rebirthing, all this body work. There's so much body work going on, massage, on and on. But the people are, you know, working on their bodies like this is going to liberate your mind. So they were onto something, actually, but they didn't really know what they were onto. And so I wanted to say, well, what exactly are we onto? I mean, what is it that we're aiming at? Dance therapy, all this stuff. It's, you need spiritual cross training. And so if you get one part of it but not the other, it doesn't really work. But if you get the 360 degreeness of it, then it's going to work. It's going to work. So the pioneers were on to something, but they only took it so far. They did not yet realize that the real non-dual teaching that we're now becoming aware of through Ramaharshi and Longchenpa and Jesus Christ and the Dharma Kings, we're now becoming aware of true non-dual teaching. Okay, and this is, it's more rarefied atmosphere, actually. In the latest video, Seize the Citadel of Non-Duality. These are quotes from Longchenpa, and putting this slideshow together, this video, it just blew my mind. It just blew my mind. I said, I just can't believe this, Longchenpa, what you're saying. It's so awesome. I'm just at a total loss for words, and I don't know what to say to you. I mean, it's just, you know, so completely awesome. What you're saying is just extraordinary, so extraordinary. It just knocked me out. Longchenpa is just a knockout artist. He's so amazing. I said, you really said that? Oh my gosh, I mean, who says that? Who even came up with this? This is just extraordinary. Just extraordinary. And so we're getting this now with thanks to the help of some translators such as Keith Dauman, who, you know, has really done a great job and is helping in the big, this is an example of someone who's helping out in the big picture. In the big picture, he's being very helpful because all this is now reaching certain people who also will be very helpful. And so it's amplifying, you know, it's kind of a rippling, amplifying effect. But we're getting the taste of the real McCoy. Okay, this is what's happening. We didn't quite have that before. Not like we do now. It's this combination of Sri Sri Nandamayama, the Dharma Kings. Snargana Maharaj, you could, you know, maybe put him in there. And you know, Punjaji was strong, Ramaharshi. And Jesus Christ with A Course in Miracles, Journey Beyond Words, the Other Voice, and then now Longchenpa with, you know, Spaciousness, the Radical Dzogchen of the Vajra Heart, and other works of the Nyingma Masters. And this stuff is now filtering, and we're getting it now very directly. This is extraordinary, what's happening. It really is. You have to realize that you're going through a time right now is the most extraordinary time in history. And you're living it. You're living it. You're living it. I could put together a video, a slideshow on Journey Beyond Words, a Journey Beyond Words. What Jesus was saying, it just knocked me out so severely, I could hardly take it. It was so massively extraordinary what he's saying. I just said, I just had no idea you could say this. Is this really? Wow. These, like Ram Maharshi, they're no compromise. And these teachers, they just tell us exactly the truth. And we're not used to this at all. We're used to spinning everything towards despair. But they don't allow that. They say, no, this is the truth. Like this, just like this. So we're getting this. And so now we have a much better understanding than we had in the 60s and the 70s and 80s and 90s. Much, much better. Way, 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 way better. So, you know, I have to show, I don't have to, I'm happy to show some respect to those. I do respect those who pioneers of the 60s, 70s, 80s, and 90s, and the 2000s. I absolutely do respect them. But, you know, they kind of had a hold of the tail of the elephant, or the trunk of the elephant or something. They had a hold of the elephant, they just weren't quite sure what they had a hold of. And now we are seeing, you know, the elephant. And many are ignoring the elephant in the room, but the elephant's in the room. Make no mistake about it, the elephant is in the room, but in a positive way. You know, we have these teachings and we're all kind of like waking up to it. And it's quite a shock. What Longchenpa says is quite shocking. It's true. I mean, what he's saying is true. It's just like, oh my gosh. I never knew you could see it that way and even express it like that. So now we can put the various body work into context. And dancing is helpful in a way, spiritually. The dancing that is gliding. You know, the crazy, some of the stuff is, you know, counterproductive. It depends how you use it, actually. Some of the wild dancing and just the, you know, the frenzied stuff, that's designed to try and, you know, alter your state and push you. But that's not where it's at all. What we're doing is smoothed out sameness. Is I move this way, I can pivot, I can move sideways and backwards, I can move up and down, I can roll on the ground, I can stand, I can pop up, I can jump up, I can move this way and that way. And it's all just a smooth flow of sameness. You know, we're not at the Headbangers Ball, you know. That's a different story, isn't it? It's like they're practicing, you know, like I'm banging my head against the wall, you know, blah, blah. That kind of thing, that frenzied sort of stuff is no, we don't do that frenzied kind of stuff. It's smooth, it's graceful. So there's something to be said for all that, the ballroom dancing, the various kinds of dancing and stuff. Is that you're moving all these different directions and turning and everything, but you always feel like you're totally poised and you're just, you know, you never lose your balance, and you're always exactly where you want to be, and so they just don't realize, you know, how to use it properly, and the insights that it can be part of, supportive of. Because in abidance, you feel like all directions are equally valid. There's this 360 degreeness. And since you're not even a point, you are, there's no such thing as a direction for you. It's everything is infinite in all directions. Everything is a dance. Everything is a song. Infinite song, infinite dance. In 360 degreeness entirely. So, you know, is there a direction there really in reality? Is there really a direction? Do we go in directions? No, because wherever we are, there's 360 degreeness there. It's never not there. So how can we say we've arrived, or there's some direction we're going in? It's not a linear thing. So what we have to do is for the body is practice sort of non-linear motions. I see people, you know, jogging. The yoga girls are out every day. They just jog. I saw some today. Wow. I mean, they look like they're going into battle or something. My gosh. They're dressing in all black now. It's like, you know, here we come. Here we go. This is like tanks going down the street or something. And they just boom, 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 like a machine going forward. I say, this is not good at all for your mind. In fact, it's bad for your mind. So we have to be aware that what we do physically is sort of the mind expressing itself, really, and the mind getting feedback and trying to train itself in a certain way, using the body as a training tool. We're so used to using the body as a training tool. The Holy Spirit's saying, why not use it as a positive training tool instead of just junking it all together? I said, well, okay, let's see what we can do here. So instead of jogging along, you know, we got to lose this joggingness. It's not where it's at all, actually. It should be passé at this point. It's not a matter how far you run or it's how you move. And you should be a little prancing, a little sashaying. A little staccato this, a little sliding here, a little sliding here, kind of running. I'm able to kind of run sideways now, kind of this, kind of little run sideways, a little this, little run the other side like this, a little spin, like if you jog, just a little spin around, 360 spin, jog, and then, you know, just break it up into all sorts of creative expressions instead of just this robotic, militaristic, you know, jackbooted jogging thing, like boom. Boom, boom, we're just relentlessly, you know, linearly, horizontally going to defeat our enemies, that the darkness that is really the light, symbolizing our fear of the light, you know. So I'm working on all of this to help. Maybe there'll be a revival and some way people will start getting it and say, hey, wait a minute, this is a lot better than what we've been doing. It's a lot better. It's happened. It happened in the decades before that people would suddenly say, you know what? Let's start doing this. It's a lot easier for people to get into physical activity than it is meditation. It's people having a lot of difficulty with meditation right now. So physically, you can do stuff that'll help you avoid the worst of the situation in the world. Yeah, I've just run into a blank, you know, stone brick wall with trying to help meditation. People just are having too much trouble with it, really. They're too robotic with it. But physically, we might be able to start doing some things. And you'd be surprised at how quickly you pick up on it, too. You say, hey, I can do this, I can do this. And singing background, I'm much freer to do that. When you're singing lead, you have some words you're singing, and You're expected to sing them in a certain way, that's what the audience expects, and so you feel kind of penned into that. Whereas singing background harmony, I feel like I can just go in any direction at all, actually. Any direction at all. 360 degreeness, I feel it. And the song will sound just as good no matter what I do, actually. If I go high, if I go low, go this direction, that direction, whatever, it all sounds good. But if you're singing the lead, then you feel a little more constrained, actually. You see, these skateboarders are mostly kids, right? And they're saying, look, I don't want to become a robot. So they do all these flips and 360s, and they're amazing, the flexibility they have. It's just what they think, BMX bikes and all the various things, motorcycles, motocross, all the various things. These are kids. And they're so, flexible and feel like, they can just go any direction at all. It's a mindset, and they're desperately trying not to succumb to the roboticism of this world, which is just a reflection of the minds that want to cast themselves into despair ultimately and try to change what they are. And they feel that this roboticism will generate the despair necessary to change what they are. This is all that's happening in the world. What worlds are just projections, mental projections, and the mind is projecting because it's trying to change what it is. And it believes that despair is transformative. So the stuff that it does, for instance, the mental chaos is the ultimate attempt that's supposed to generate enough despair to change what we are. And it doesn't at all. We can't change what we are, but what we're projecting, this design, is it's really for the purpose of despair. That's it. We're trying to get enough despair that'll change what we are, and then we think once we change what we are, we'll have this newfound happiness. So we really think despair leads to happiness, and it doesn't. Despair just leads to despair. That's it, and that's a very tough recognition to handle, and I'm still working at it. It's just wow, it didn't lead to anything. Just despair leads to more despair. That's it. It just compounds itself, and that's then you just feel I'm just stuck in despair. Just the body language of the world has changed drastically over the last 60 years. Drastic change in body language. I mean, people used to be able to pivot and walk backwards and chat and then turn sideways this and they used to be way more Now we have people who are fit but robotically fit. So do stuff sideways, go sideways. If you go upstairs sideways. You can do it two different ways. You can just go one, let me see how to bump and step at the same step, then bump, 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 bump. Or you can go step and cross over your another foot to the next stairs. And then cross, and then cross, and then cross, and keep crossing, cross, and this one's cross, cross, and you could do different, all sorts of different things to just make your motion and movement different than just this linear horizontalness, because that's will never, as Longchenpa points out, that'll never get you to liberation. It will not. Oh, ultimately, the great meditators transcend all that. They're able to get into true meditation. But how successful are we at getting into true meditation? How successful have we been? Very poor, very poor. Poverty stricken. We live in a spiritual ghetto right now. Yeah, so. And I just keep inventing. I just thought inventing new exercises that just, like roll up the BOSU ball and then just roll over it. I'll put that in the way and I'll just do my rolling and then have to roll up the ball and then roll down it. This completely flexes the body in a different way than we're ever used to in experiencing. So we could put the body through these different kinds of experiencing and the exercising. It's like, wow, I didn't know I could do that. I didn't know I could do that. I didn't know that was possible. And it sort of starts expanding in a non-robotic way. It may be that body work in some way like this is something that would work for the world. It's just meditate, being able to meditate just is for the rare few right now, it seems like. But at least that will protect their mental health to a certain extent. At least that will do that. And that sets them up then for really deeper meditations, deeper recognitions. Like the Holy Spirit told me, mentally you're fine. Everything's fine. No, and physically want you to do some more work to be in better shape. Okay. Oh, wow. So it may be that we're having trouble getting to the more mental, the focus. Yeah, we're having trouble. This is what's been happening over the last, gradually seems like we're just not able because of all the action, our whole environment, entertainment, our culture, action, 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 right? Everybody's so into superheroes, the kids, action, 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 action. Video games. Everybody's into action. It's a pretty hard sell to say sit quietly for 2.5 hours and don't move and just sit here and just sit in the wow for 2.5 hours. Now this is something profoundly helpful to do this, but it seems like a virtually impossible sell. Nobody's doing it. Yeah, I'm doing it, and there might be a few. I don't know if others are doing 2.5 hours a day or more. Able to just sit quietly. Some are. The numbers are probably extremely few because of just the overall materialistic focus. So we may have to deal with that in some way of saying, okay, use that focus and spin it in another direction, so it helps out. Helps your mental focus. Walk into a room backwards. We always do the same thing. I walk into a room forwards. Why do I have to walk into a room forwards? Why not just walk in backwards? Just do it. It's like, whoa, I didn't know I could do that. I thought it seems like everything is going to suddenly collapse, but nothing collapsed. I feel fine. I just walked into a room. Like at work, you come into work, walk in the door backwards and walk to your desk backwards. Okay, and we don't do that. Why? You could greet people as you pass them backwards. In hindsight, you'll see them and you'll say, hey, how's it? Good morning, good morning. Instead of as you're walking forward, you say, good morning, good morning. You're walking backwards as you, after you pass them, you'll see them, they'll smile and say, hey, nice to see you, good morning, like that. You could still do that, walk to your desk backwards or sideways or spinning. Maybe you could roll to your desk in the morning. Why not? Probably will help your productivity. But we're such efficiency freaks and materialistic freaks in the world that really is freakish, weird and freakish the way people are in the world now. They should be recognizing their spiritual opportunity, and instead they don't, which is very freakish, very weird. And we see commercials of people doing that because we all deep down we want to. So all these kind of commercials where people are doing stuff that you want to do, but nobody ever actually does it. They just kind of, and they, that's why they get hooked into television entertainment, is the commercials are such that they're geniuses, the commercial marketers. They know you have this secret longing. And so they show it in the commercial, so you love watching that, actually. And then you'll watch the shows which program you to be a robot. Pretty clever, huh? For me, I don't miss the commercial because I am doing it myself. I am doing all that stuff and even, you know, more. And so I don't need to watch television to see this stuff. I see it in my own mind. I'm doing it. So I don't have, I miss all the shows, the entertainments, and so I'm not being programmed to be a robot. It's pretty amazing. So you really have to learn to entertain yourself, learn to knock yourself out, to wow yourself, so you're not tempted into the spider's web. Again, the powers that be in this world are very smart and clever, and they know our psychology to such an extent that they know we have this longing, and so they show this in commercials for products, and we say, oh yeah, I get that car, I can do donuts, wow, I want to do donuts. And then you kind of like accept then the program that they give. Your mind has kind of been put into a frame of acceptance. And then they hook you. It's like a lure they use to hook a fish. You could do that stuff in the world, but if I videotape you, I'd have to say, I'm just doing a commercial. I'm working on a commercial shoot here. People say, oh, okay, yeah, okay. And people, you just don't do it. But the 60s people did it, you know? They did it. You'd see somebody doing something that was just like, it was surreal. Everybody was doing stuff that seemed surreal, but it was so cool. It was so cool to see that, to see all these young people just deciding that, you know, I'm just going to, you know, do a dance with this fire hydrant or something. Why not? Or going across the crosswalk, they were going to like crawl across it or roll across it. Or it just goes endless. I mean, it just, you know, in other words, I'm not just going to be a corporate robot. And so they actually lived it out on the streets and in stores and everything. And it was so lovely and so wonderful. And we miss that to extreme extent right now. We're so buttoned down and so corporate, it's insane. And you don't see a revolution coming from the young people. They're so hooked into their smartphones now that they're like zombies walking down the street. And people my age, most of them, you know, they're burned out. They've had enough. They're just counting their eggs, you know, for retirement, just trying to figure out. That's interesting. I don't have anything for retirement and don't even think about it. But everyone I talk to, my age, they just, yeah, okay, they got it all figured out. You know, their focus is on how do I retire? How do I keep enough money until I die? And for me, yeah, I never even think about it. This is a little disconcerting. really. Maybe we'll just start walking on water, actually. That would be a nice little statement. Sort of an upgrade from the 60s. People wore eccentric clothes in the 60s from thrift shops, Victorian clothes. They were very much into being surreal. But intelligently surreal, for the most part. Until the drugs really messed it up, but many people were not so much into drugs. They were very intelligent, and it was a political, social, cultural statement of I'm not going to be a robot in my life, And so I'm intentionally doing this stuff to make sure I don't get pulled into that trap. And you can, when you're in the creative mode, it's just you can feel expressive. Just do all sorts of stuff. You know, you just you walk along. It's a bottle cap. You say, you know what? This bottle cap's going to point the way. I'm picking it up. I did that recently. Pick up a bottle cap. It was this beautiful palm tree, red background, beautiful palm, two palm trees. And I put it in my pocket. I said, I'm bringing that home. They might walk along and see some pebbles, and they sit, they just, you know, pick up a pebble and put it here and put this one here, you know, and just say, ah, bless you. Now, is it some special arrangement? No. It was just, but just the act of doing it. It was the act of doing it. And of course, the square, called the square culture, straight culture, the squareness, meaning corporate efficiency culture. They couldn't understand, what are you doing? What does that have to do with efficiency? And we would say, well, it has to do with non-enslavement is what it has to do with. We don't want to be a slave to efficiency, materialistic efficiency. So this is sort of a song of liberation from that. It's a song of liberation. I just composed a song. I rearranged the pebbles. I have some pebbles on the ground. I pick one up, move this one here, move this one there. Is that psychotic? Is that crazy? No, that's a song of liberation. So the people of the 60s were not psychotic or crazy. They were very intelligent. And we like to look back, say, oh, the kooks, you know, this funny stuff. No, they had a very strong purpose of what they were doing. The Marx Brothers did a bunch of goofy stuff in their movies, didn't they? Which was, people loved to see that. Because it was just, it was non, you know, it was outside the boundaries of efficiency and roboticism. They kept going through revolving doors and spinning around and do all this stuff. And it's a madcap sort of thing. But it was, you know, the kids loved the Marx Brothers movies because they said, I'd like to live like that. Why can't life be like a Marx Brothers movie? Oh, because we got to raise the kids the right way. What do you mean raise the kids? We're raising the kids in the wrong way. Why can't we raise our kids in the right way? We keep getting it all wrong. Now, you know, what's going to happen? I don't know. I don't know. But you remember some videos of the 60s? You could see people like, and like Golden Gate Park or something. They'd just be like, you know, kind of twirling around, going in circles, and just making like motions like this, you know, circular motions and stuff like that, instead of machine-like robotic motions of kind of, and they're trying to, you know, they go around and they might just be standing there like this. Well, you all assume that they're on drugs or something. Not necessarily at all. Some of them were. But actually, you don't have to, you know, drugs don't have to be a part of it at all. They shouldn't be, actually. You're just standing there like this. And you're just saying, look, everything's a song. So just sitting here, just standing here like this is a song too. There's nothing I need to do to hear the song. I am the song. Everything is the song. Like the chimes. Do they have to hit in some pattern? No. Isn't it all good? Whatever pattern the breeze hits, isn't it all beautiful tones? Sure. stockholders, say we have products we want to sell you. Well, maybe we're not interested in your products. You ever thought of that? Never crosses their mind. Maybe we're actually not interested in any of your products. They say, no, you got to, you know, live this kind of life, so you buy all these products, all our products, so we get, you know, our company, our stock, we get rich off of it. And say, why? You want to use the products, you buy them. We don't really need all those products at all. Who are you to tell me how I have to live my life? I have to live my life to enrich you from buying all these products? That's a slave. It's like cattle. Here, you have to go, you know, you're a cow, you got to live on my ranch and produce the milk for me. Well, I'm not a cow. I don't have to live on your ranch. You know, you want to be a cow, go ahead. Milk yourself, but don't, you know, you buy the products if you want them so badly. These people are trying to get rich, and they think they come up with an idea. You know, hey, let's make these hamburgers, okay? Well, let's see who I can sell them to. Let me see if I can try to sell them to as many people as possible. Let me try to convince people they need to eat my hamburgers. You know, it's a need that they have. But they're trying to do that to be super successful, and they think that that's going to make them happy. But does that make them happy? No, it never has made them happy. Nice crickets are calling out. Corporations have been programming our religion and our manifest destiny and brainwashing us for so long. Roman Empire was one of the, you know, Egyptians' empire, Roman Empire, various empires. They're like the masters of brainwashing, actually. Roman Catholicism, there's a reason why I call it Roman Catholicism. Because it was really used as a administrative bureaucratic tool of the Roman Empire. Because there's a reason why I call it Roman Empire, is because they conquered, you know, everybody they could fight. They never met a people they didn't want to conquer, and they you know, just conquer. Well, you have all these people you've conquered. How do you administer the country and the land you now control, and all these heathens that have all these other bizarre customs and maybe very warlike and fractious and this, that way. Well, the Romans decided to take early Christianity and blend it with Egyptian and various other stuff and make it into a tool of pacifying the lands that they conquered under fear, like, well, there's this terribly angry God that if you don't, this is what this God wants to do all of you, and here's this picture of Jesus Christ crucified, and this is what God wants to do to you, and the only way that God's not going to do that to you is if you accept Jesus Christ your Savior, and the only way you can do that is come to this church, and the only way you can ultimately be saved is to eat this wafer, but only our bureaucrats have the capacity to change the wafer into the blood and flesh of Jesus, so you can only get it here. And so it's just this massive system of control that they used. Yeah, it's very brilliant. I mean, shrewd and brilliant what they did. Scared the heck out of the people. Yeah. Crucified Jesus, they used that. They said, look, God is a ferocious God, a wrathful God. God, we're all sinners. God hates us and wants to absolutely give us the most terrible death, crucify us. And he said, and so he showed it, used his only begotten son to show us, this is what I want to do to all you. But if you accept this religion in the name of Jesus, then this won't happen to you. But you have to accept the religion. You have to accept me, Rome, God, Rome, and do what you're told to do. Otherwise, you're going to be crucified. So that's a very powerful message, a very frightening, intimidating message. And it worked wonders, didn't it? In terms of subjugating people, keeping them under control, bureaucratically, administratively, and such. Yeah. That's what it's really about. It has nothing to do with salvation, actually. Nothing at all. I was listening to this radio. I actually turned on the radio. I wanted to listen to some oldies so I can practice harmonizing. And what I got was this Christian, not a Catholic radio station. And so I was listening to it. And there are apologetics and criticizing Protestantism and saying how terrible it is and how wrong it is and how you have to have the central authority and the Roman Catholicism is the only true religion, blah, blah. I was like, wow, man. You know, it has nothing to do with salvation, really, Roman Catholicism. It doesn't have anything to do with salvation. It has to do with subjugation. And of course, they say, yeah, after you die, yeah, or you get it after you die, don't worry. Yeah, they want to make sure that you are a nice, good little Roman Empire citizen, paying your taxes and behaving yourself, and then dying. And they say, good job, thank you very much. And the reward, yeah, the reward is it's there in heaven after you die. As long as you were dutiful and did what we told you to do, yeah, you get to go to heaven. Like they write you a ticket to get there. That has absolutely zero to do with liberation. Zero. Nothing to do with it. And they know that. I mean, throughout history, the popes, you know, come on, they know it's like this story, this thing, this all, this religion we have has worked well for us, hasn't it? Yeah. And it, you know, keeps the vast wealth pouring into the higher ups, which is what they want. Keep, you know, gives, it makes the world nice for corporations and docile people serving those corporations, docile slaves. They want docile slaves. And it, you know, it's designed specifically for that. They want docile slaves. But again, there's nothing in there at all that has anything to do with salvation. Nothing at all, actually. It's got some bells and whistles and trappings and stuff, but as far as all the messages go, there's nothing at all there. It's wrong on every account, actually. It's mistaken on every account. It's something that from the ego designed to produce docile slaves, keep people under control, using fear and carrot and stick. Yeah, if you do wrong, you could be crucified, but if you do what we tell you to do, you get to go to heaven. Which one do you want? That's your choice. And of course, if you point out this is all false, in historically, they'd say, well, you're a heretic. You know, and good luck in dealing with that. You go on and on and on. So I was just stunned by it. I just, oh my God, they're just so... There was mentioned that some lady saying, someone, a caller called up and said, I have a friend who's a Protestant. She says that what I need to do is just empty my mind of all thoughts and all content about me and my person, you know, person, and just listen to the Holy Spirit. Be quiet and listen to the Holy Spirit. That's how I live my life. And they just said, oh my God, that is so incredibly wrong. There's nothing in the Bible and in church tradition that's just, you know, the worst thing possible. No, you got to listen to Roman authority. What is she doing? That's I said, no, that's exactly what you're supposed to be doing. That's exactly right. And they just used that example of the something that's the most incorrect. Of course. They don't want anyone listening. They say, no, you can't listen to the Holy Spirit directly. You have to listen. There's authorities that God has given to tell you what the Holy Spirit wants you to do. And that's, of course, the Roman Catholic hierarchy. And that's what they said. They said, no, the whole God's plan is you listen to authority, do what authority says. You're not able to listen to the Holy Spirit directly. You'll get it all messed. That's what's wrong with the world, they said. No. That's not what's wrong. They have it backwards. And they have a half-truth there, you know, that guidance is great, right encouragement is great. There's nothing wrong with right authority. They just have it backwards. You want to encourage people to drop, Jesus says, drop, you know, drop all thoughts and let all thoughts go and let your mind be still and That's the answer. Because then the Holy Spirit will show up with and you'll know exactly, will tell you exactly what to do. You will know what to do. You will know how to live your life the way God wants you to live your life. So this is something that, of course, if you're trying to be an empire builder, you don't want this teaching at all. You want everybody to be your slaves. So the money flows in from all the provinces and you know, overflows in the banquet tables of those who are in charge. Yeah. So it's pretty disturbing to see that so clearly. It's just wow. It's unfortunately it's true. Now they couldn't get rid of all the good parts of it. They've been trying and they're pretty far along now. They just spin it and spin it and spin it and spin it. It's basically saying, they said, no, the Pope in Rome, he'll tell you everything you need to know about religion, about truth, about what you need to do. He'll give you the direct scoop on God's word. You don't need any personal inspiration at all. You just have to follow orders. Oh. But don't worry. You know, after you die, you get to heaven. If I follow our orders, and of course, this isn't true at all. You transmigrate into another life because you have no idea of what reality is. You haven't paid any attention to it, ignored it. You just followed orders of the slave owners who themselves have no idea of what God's will is. They just assume and tell everybody it's God's will is that you serve us and do what we tell you to do. Divine right of kings, huh? So sitting quietly, listening, allowing the Holy Spirit to inspire us is a big no-no. They said, that's what causes all the problem. No, we don't do that. The Pope has, the Holy Spirit has something to say, they'll tell the Pope will tell you, and you'll know. Meanwhile, be industrious and generate a lot of wealth for us. yeah. Don't cause troubles, don't rock the boat in the empire here. So there's, you know, they're trying to set up a new world order, which is just a, you know, one big empire in the world. You better believe they don't want us letting go of the past, letting go of our thoughts, being still, and allowing the Holy Spirit to inspire us. You better believe that's the last thing they want. And people are worried about that. Then along comes the ex-Pope Emeritus Francis. And he says, no, this is good works and all this. Well, I'll tell you, you know, this is what you need to do. And he said, you mean it's okay to be a slave? Oh, yeah. No, the corporations are okay. Don't worry about it. I'll tell you exactly what you need to do. And all the plantation owner said, yeah, that's great. Get him away from direct divine inspiration. Channel it all into good works. Get rid of that faith. You know, that's dangerous stuff. Those miracles, those true miracles, the instantaneousness, don't need to cure anything. I don't need to cure anything. There's nothing in my reality that needs to be cured at all. Just said, there's nothing in my reality that needs to be cured at all. There is nothing in my reality that needs to be cured at all. Nothing at all in my reality needs to be cured. Never has been, never will be. I'm totally beyond any necessity for any cure at all. Just feel this. Say it, feel it, believe it. Say it, feel it, believe it. Say it, believe it, feel it. You can say it, save it, say it, believe it, feel it. Say it, believe it, feel it. Okay. I don't want to stay up too late. The Holy Spirit wants me to do some sort of workout. I don't know. We'll see how it goes. Wants me to be, I don't know. I could only do so much. And the body feels it, you know, it's tired. It's like, oh, sore, tired. It's like, wow. Okay, so say it, believe it, feel it. There's nothing I need to cure. There's never anything in my experience that needs to be cured at all. Very powerful statement. Knocks out time, space, process, and form entirely, doesn't it? Because we're completely in control of whatever we're experiencing. If we want to experience something different, there's no need for a cure. We just experience something different directly. Directly. If I'm experiencing cancer, I just decide I'm going to experience the absence of cancer. You know, healthy tissue or something. And I just, that's what it is now. That's what I'm experiencing now. Don't ever think you need to cure anything. Because cure means process. There's some process I have to apply to something to get it to change into what I want. There's never any process we need to apply for something our experiencing to be changed. Our experiencing is always direct. It's always instantaneous. It's always immediate. We make it seem like it isn't by incremental changes in our experiencing that seems like a cure. But actually, each instant we're experiencing exactly what we want to experience. There isn't any process taking place at all. It's an illusion. Process is totally an illusion, and therefore time is an illusion also, isn't it? Time is inferred from process, but process is a total illusion. Every single instant we're experiencing exactly what we choose to experience. Nothing more, nothing less. So what time is absurdity in such a situation? Process is absurdity. There's never an instant where we're not experiencing exactly what we want to experience. So what use could the notion of time be at all? It can't possibly even arise, right? Time would imply you need to do something first to experience what you want to experience. We never need to do anything first. We're always experiencing what we want to experience. It's just that most of it we're experiencing, we're trying to generate despair to change what we are. That's why our experiencing doesn't seem to be so nice. And we reject the notion that we're always experiencing what we want to experience because we say, well, I wouldn't choose to experience this. Sure, we would. If we wanted to generate despair, that's exactly what we would experience. We just think despair is our salvation, so we don't question it. People say, well, I didn't want to get sick. Oh, yes, you did. Because that sickness is helping you. You think it's generating despair, which you believe is going to liberate you into some great happiness. It'll change what you are. It'll be greater than God. So this is the price that we end up paying. And it doesn't pay off at all, ultimately. All right. There's nothing ever in my life that needs to be cured. There's no such thing as any curing in my life. Nothing needs to be cured. I'm beyond any cure whatsoever, completely beyond any cure whatsoever. This is absolute true, non-dual truth. And we can just say it, believe it, feel it. Say it, believe it, feel it. Say it, believe it, feel it. Say it, believe it, and feel it. Okay, very great. Like I said, I don't know what I'm going to do from one moment to the next. Just have to keep on dancing. Right, keep on dancing. Very great. Keep on dancing, keep on singing. Keep on not curing anything at all. Okay, that's it.